In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. We gather on this solemnity of the Holy Family. On this day, we're reminded of the great gift that is the family. Although it has many challenges, it is a beautiful gift because it teaches us to do precisely what we were created to do, to love and to be loved. Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries.
Lord Jesus, you are mighty God and Prince of Peace. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are the Son of God and Son of Mary. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are the Word made flesh and splendor of the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Let us pray. O God, who are pleased to give us the shining example of the Holy Family, graciously grant that we may imitate them in practicing the virtues of family life and in the bonds of charity. And so, in the joy of your house, delight one day in eternal rewards. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
A reading from the first book of Samuel. In those days, Hannah conceived, and at the end of her term, bore a son, whom she called Samuel, since she had asked the Lord for him. The next time her husband, Elkanah, was going up with the rest of his household to offer the customary sacrifice to the Lord and to fulfill his vows, Hannah did not go, explaining to her husband, "Once the child is weaned, I will take him to appear before the Lord and to remain there forever. I will offer him as a perpetual Nazirite." Once Samuel was weaned, Hannah brought him up with her, along with a 3-year-old bowl, an ephah of flour, and a skin of wine, and presented him at the temple of the Lord in Shiloh. After the boy's father had sacrificed the young bull, Hannah, his mother, approached Eli and said, "Pardon, my lord, as you live, my lord, I am the woman who stood near you here praying to the Lord. I prayed for this child, and the Lord granted my request. Now I, in turn, give him to the Lord. As long as he lives, he shall be dedicated to the Lord." Hannah left Samuel there. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Blessed are those who fear the Lord. Blessed are those who fear the Lord. Blessed are all who fear the Lord and walk in his ways. By the labor of your hands you shall eat. You will be blessed and prosper. Blessed are those who fear the Lord. Your wife, like a fruitful vine, in the heart of your house, your children like shoots of the olive around your table. Blessed are those who fear the Lord. Indeed, thus shall be blessed the man who fears the Lord. May the Lord bless you from Zion. May you see Jerusalem prosper all the days of your life. Blessed are those who
A reading from the first letter of St. John. Beloved, see what love the Father has bestowed on us, that we may be called the children of God. And so we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we shall be has not yet been revealed. We do not know that when it is revealed, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Beloved, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have confidence in God and receive from him whatever we ask, because we keep his commandments and do what pleases him. And his commandment is this: we should believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another just as he commanded us. Those who keep his commandments remain in him, and he in them. And the way we know that he remains in us is from the Spirit he gave us. The word of the Lord.
The peace of Christ control your hearts. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Each year, Jesus' parents went to Jerusalem for the feast of Passover. And when he was 12 years old, they went up according to the festival's custom. After they had completed its days, and as they were returning, the boy remained behind in Jerusalem, but his parents did not know it. Thinking that he was with the caravan, they journeyed for a day and looked for him among their relatives and acquaintance, but did not find him. They returned to Jerusalem looking for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting amidst the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard him were astounded at his understanding and his answers. When his parents saw him, they were astonished. And his mother said to him, "Son, why have you done this to us? Your father and I have been looking for you with great anxiety." And he said to them, "Why were you looking for me? Did you not know that I must be in my father's house?" But they did not understand what he said to them. He went down with them and came to Nazareth and was obedient to them. And his mother kept all these things in her heart. And Jesus advanced in wisdom and age and favor before God and man. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you.
Good evening, everyone. To lose a child, I think, is one of the scariest things that can ever happen to a parent. One minute, your child is standing by your side. The next minute, he or she is gone. This happened to my wife a few times when my children were younger and we were at the shopping malls, for they had a little game they liked to play where they hid underneath the clothing racks and we had to find them. Fortunately, we would usually find them rather quickly, but still for those few seconds until we did, we were in pure panic mode. I'm sure many parents here today have had a similar experience. Those of you who do not have children or maybe not old enough to have children yet, perhaps you've been in the situation where you were with friends in a large crowd, and suddenly you lost sight of them because you were either distracted or some large group has gotten in front of you, separating you from your friends. Whatever the situation is, it can be very, very distressing. Can you imagine how stressed out Joseph and Mary were when they could not find Jesus? I cannot imagine anything worse than to lose the Son of God. We hear that this was not Jesus and Mary and Joseph's first trip to Jerusalem. We were told they went every year. This was a major accomplishment, for Nazareth was 60 miles from Jerusalem. It took a good 3 days on foot to get to Jerusalem. The family would usually stay there for a week of celebration before returning home. I'm sure that cost a great deal of money and it was a true act of devotion. Jesus was well aware of this routine, for they said they went up every year. So why did he not stay with Mary and Joseph this time when they returned home? We heard today that when Mary and Joseph discovered Jesus was missing, they immediately returned to Jerusalem. Now this would only take one day, because it said they were just journeying for one day before they discovered him missing. They then spent two more days looking for him before they found him in the temple. Why they went to the temple is not known. Perhaps they were desperate and decided that they needed to pray to God for him to help him find their son. I can only imagine when they did see Jesus in the temple, they were pretty upset. And I cannot blame Mary for being angry at Jesus and telling him about the great anxiety he caused them and asking him, "Why have you done this to us?" I would guess, too, that Mary probably did not say this in a low, calm voice. She may have been yelling at him. And Jesus' answer almost seemed like he was being a smart mouth. But this was Jesus. Surely he was not being disrespectful to Mary and Joseph. So I ask you again, why did he this one time stay in Jerusalem instead of returning to Nazareth with Mary and Joseph? I want to tell you a true story that will help you answer this question. Fred Craddock was a famous preacher. He died just a few years ago in 2015. A few years before he died, though, he was invited to the prestigious Yale to deliver a series of lectures on preaching. During one of these stories, he told a personal story. He was on vacation with his wife in the Smoky Mountains. And they were out dinner at a nice restaurant. And during the dinner, a nice old gentleman came up to him, introduced himself by saying good evening, and Craddock said good evening back. And then he started up a conversation with him, asking him several questions, which was starting to annoy Craddock because he was wanting to have a nice dinner with his wife. One of the last questions he asked him, though, was what did Craddock do for a living? And Craddock told him he was a preacher. The old man said, "Then I have a story for you." Craddock reluctantly listened to the old man's story, and he's glad he did. He started by saying that he was born in the nearby mountains, Smoky Mountains. His mother was not married, and everyone knew it. The kids had a bad name for him that they always called him, and it hurt. When recess came at school, he would not even play with them. He would go hide in the weeds until recess was over, and then he would come back in. The old man said that when he was in the 7th and 8th grade, though, he decided to start going to church. The preacher, he said, looked really severe and frightened the boy, but he's also attracted to him at the same time. The boy was afraid, though, that people would wonder why he was there and what he's doing in church. So he would always slip in really late and then leave early before people started leaving church so nobody could catch him. Then one Sunday, though, when he looked to escape after the service was over, he found the pews were blocked. He could not get out. He started to break out into sweat, figuring that someone was going to ask him, "What's a boy like you doing in church?" All of a sudden, he became aware of a hand on his shoulders, and the preacher was standing over him. The boy cowered, awaiting the public humiliation that he was sure was coming. Sure enough, the preacher made some comment about whose child was he, but then he said, "Well, boy, you're a child of, wait. And then the preacher said, "You're a child of God. I see the resemblance in your face." And he swatted the boy on the back and said, "Go claim your inheritance." Craddock asked the old man his name, And the man said his name was Ben Hooper. Craddock remembered his father telling him about the state of Tennessee electing then what they used to call an illegitimate child to be governor of their fine state. That governor's name was Ben Hooper. That day in church was a turning point for Ben Hooper's life. Ben Hooper became a brand new person that one Sunday when he realized that he did have a father. He had a heavenly father. Jesus was not being smart mouthed with Mary and Joseph. He loved his parents. And after that day, we heard he returned back and was obedient to them and grew in wisdom. On that day, though, he was reminding them that he had another heavenly father that he loved and had to be obedient to also, God the Father. We all have that same father, a father whom Jesus has taught us about, a father that is the best father of the prodigal son you could ever imagine. He welcomes us back home no matter how bad we've been, and he forgives us as a prodigal father, a father of the prodigal son did. God is there to love us in our darkest moments when we hit rock bottom and we have nowhere else to turn. I love the quote of Abraham Lincoln that Father Martin used several homilies ago, and it fits so well here. Abraham Lincoln said, "I've been driven many times upon my knees by the overwhelming conviction that I had nowhere else to go. My own wisdom and all that about me seemed insufficient for that day." On this Holy Family Sunday, Jesus is reminding each and every one of us, we have a Father in heaven who loves us no matter what. We are members of a holy family also. We are members of his family. So as a preacher said to that boy on that Sunday, I also say to you, you are all children of God. I see the resemblance in each and every one of you, and I don't want you ever to forget that. Amen.
I believe in one God, Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. Christ reigned for our salvation. As children of God, we bring our intercessions to the Lord with confidence, knowing he will receive what we offer.
That all members of the church seek to live out in peace and tranquility, their call to be the family of God, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That countries of the world seek to safeguard and protect the earth our common home, we pray to the Lord. That families in crisis might find the help and support they need to flourish and thrive, we pray to the Lord. That all gather here might strive to be faithful and loving members of the families we belong to, we pray to the Lord. For St. Mark's Parish in Haiti, we pray to the Lord. Let us pray for an increase in vocation to priesthood, the diaconate, and religious life. We pray to the Lord. Heavenly Father, grant eternal rest to all who have passed on to their eternal glory, and to Thomas More, for whom this Mass is offered. We pray to the Lord.
God, Father of all, through your Son Jesus, you invite us to claim our rightful places at your beloved, as your beloved sons and daughters. Hear the prayers we bring before you, that through the intercession of the Holy Family, we might become a sign of your love in the world, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. We offer you, Lord, the sacrifice of conciliation, humbly asking that through the intercession of the Virgin Mother of God and Saint Joseph, you may establish our families firmly in your grace and your peace, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For on the feast of this awe-filled mystery, though invisible in his own divine nature, he has appeared visibly in ours. And begotten before all ages, he has begun to exist in time, so that raising up in himself all that was cast down, he might restore unity to all creation and call straying humanity back to the heavenly kingdom. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim.
Sanctus, Sanctus, Sanctus Dominus Deus Sabaoth, pleni sunt celi et terra gloria tua, Hosanna in excelsis, benedictus qui venit in nomine
indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and confess your resurrection until you come.
therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May you make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint James and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Joseph, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. And your compassionate, merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen, amen, amen.
At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope in the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let's offer each other a sign of peace.
We told you.
Behold, the Lamb of God. Behold, him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not
child is this who laid to rest on Mary's lap is sleeping, whom angels greet with anthems sweet, while shepherds watch are Amen.
Let us pray. Bring those you refresh with this heavenly sacrament, most merciful Father, to imitate constantly the example of the Holy Family, so that after the trials of this world, you may share their company forever, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
If you could please be seated for a moment. With Father Martin's blessing and encouragement, I would like to make a statement. I understand that my Christmas homily was received in many different ways. I've received considerable positive feedback from it, but also considerable negative feedback. I said in my homily that the first task of the priest is to lead the people of God to heaven. That task compels every priest to preach the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ, both in word and in action. With that in mind, I stand by the truth of the challenging and uncomfortable message that I delivered. However, in my zeal, it seems the words and the tone that I used to deliver it caused some a great deal of disappointment and concern. As a very convicted convert to Catholicism, I have strong Bible-thumping tendencies within me that do not often get expressed in my preaching. Unfortunately, I think they were unleashed in my Christmas homily in such a way that I fear had unintended consequences. In my naivete as a young priest, my passion and conviction distracted, it seems, from the message. A priest should never stand in the way of proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ. Regrettably, it seems that's precisely what happened. At the end of the day, I could beg for your forgiveness or attempt to explain why I said what I said, but I do not want to make this about myself. I want it always to be about Jesus Christ. If you know me on a personal level, you know how deeply devoted I am to him and to safeguarding his Holy Eucharist. And it seems I may have failed him and his people in my passion. Please pray for me as I continue to grow into the priest that Jesus and the Blessed Mother need me to be. My only recourse is to beg the Blessed Mother to undo the knots that I have caused in my overzealous preaching. I will be offering my daily rosary for the next month for all the souls that my preaching may have pushed away, for the Most Sacred Heart of Jesus and the Immaculate Heart of Mary. I will also be doing penance throughout the month of January. I would be more than happy to talk with anyone who has any questions or concerns. My door is always open. Praised be Jesus Christ.
The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Mass is ended. Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.
Good Christian friends, rejoice with heart and soul and voice. All give heed to what we say. Jesus Christ is born today. Ox and ass before him bow, and he is in the manger now. Christ is born today. Christ is born today. Good Christian friends, rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Now you hear of endless bliss. Jesus Christ was born for this. He has opened heaven's door, and we are blessed forevermore.
Christian friends rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Now you need not fear the grave. Jesus Christ was born to save, calls you one and calls you all.